Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome to the course Developmental Biology. I am Dr. Priya Goyal, Assistant Professor in Department of Zoology, Deen Dayal Upadhyay College of University of Delhi. In this lecture, we will continue with teratogenesis. This is the syllabus of Developmental Biology that we are following, and we are doing the Unit 5, that is Implications of Developmental Biology, in which we have started with the topic teratogenesis. In part 1 of teratogenesis, we have studied what are teratogens and teratogenesis, what are the principles of teratology, also what are the effects of various teratogenic agents on embryonic development, in which we are done with natural teratogens, and we are currently doing pharmaceutical drugs and chemicals. We will also take up endocrine disruptors, the industrial teratogens, in which we will study heavy metals, microbial teratogens, recreational teratogens, metabolic conditions in the mother, and abnormal development without mutation in this second part of the lecture. So let us begin with part 2 of the lecture, teratogenesis. We are done with one pharmaceutical teratogen, that is thalidomide. Now the second pharmaceutical teratogen is retinoic acid. Retinoic acid is an active metabolite of vitamin A and is responsible for all the biological activities that vitamin A has inside the human body. The normally low levels of retinoic acid are secreted by certain discrete cells. And normally, retinoic acid is essential for the formation of anterior-posterior axis and limbs in the embryo. It plays an important role in signaling. But an overexposure of retinoic acid induces widespread teratogenesis. The critical period of retinoic acid is between 20 to 35 days post-conception in case of humans and 8 to 10 days post-conception in case of mice. That is, during this period, the effect of retinoic acid is maximum on the embryo if this exposure is given to the pregnant woman. It is a component of drug Accutane, in which it is present in the form of 13-cis retinoic acid or isotretinoin. And this Accutane drug was introduced in the market in the year 1982 to treat severe cystic acne. But exposure to retinoic acid during pregnancy induces growth delay before and after birth of the child. That is, it causes intrauterine growth restriction and also postnatal growth retardation. Retinoic acid exposure can lead to spontaneous abortions or a characteristic pattern of anomalies in the fetus, which includes certain craniofacial changes, that is, changes in the cranium and the face. The jaws may be absent or small in size. It can cause cleft palate. It can cause aortic arch abnormalities. It may lead to certain kind of deficiencies in the thymus gland. It may cause defective ears, or even the ears may be absent altogether. There can be certain neural tube defects. There can be cardiovascular malformations or even kidney alterations, aside causing a low IQ in the child. Now, what is the mechanism of action of this retinoic acid? Retinoic acid causes a major effect on the FOX genes. Now, 11-cis retinoic acid, which is the active form of retinoic acid, it binds to its receptor, which further binds to specific enhancer elements inside the cell in the DNA called retinoic acid response elements. The enhancer is present in some FOX genes, thus affecting the expression of FOX genes on the early patterning of the embryo. So low levels of retinoic acid will cause will generate the anterior posterior axis of the embryo, while high levels of retinoic acid will alter the early patterning of the embryo. So there is an alternate effect of the low levels and high levels of retinoic acid as is. So this prevents the migration of pleural crest cells from the cranial region of the neural tube into the parenchyal arches of the face, where they proliferate to form the jaws and this is interesting to note here that certain glyphosate-based herbicides, for example, the Roundup, have also been reported to upregulate the activity of endogenous retinoic acid, as has been seen experimentally in zebras embryos. So we are continuing with pharmaceutical teratogens, in which the next pharmaceutical teratogen that we are going to take up is valproic acid. Valproic acid is used as an anticonvulsant drug to control epilepsy. It comes under the category of anti-epileptic drug, that is AET. Exposure of mother during pregnancy to valproic acid impairs cognitive development and increases risk rate of autism incidence of the child. High doses during pregnancy may cause bone defects, competitively inhibiting folate metabolism, which is required for the neural tube differentiation of the embryo. It leads to multi-organ system anomalies, including those of the neural tube, because it competitively inhibits folate metabolism, as we discussed here. It may cause abnormalities of the spinal column. It may cause spina bifida, as you can see in this diagram here. This is an open defect of the spina bifida in the newborn child. It may cause midfacial hypoplasia. It may lead to deficient orbital ridge of the child. The forehead may be quite prominent. Postnatal growth may also be decreased, or there can be certain deformities at the extremities, which includes polydactyly, arachnodactyly, or even rudimentary fingers. As you see, this is an additional finger present here, that is polydactyly. But here also there are six fingers in the hand. Other important effects include those of cardiovascular, respiratory, and urinogenital systems. It has been found during an experiment in Chick that that valproic acid causes a decrease in the level of paired box or PAX1 transcription in Chick somites, which causes malformations of the vertebrae and ribs, which are derived from the somites in the Chick. Another important pharmaceutical teratogen is warfarin. Warfarin is sold under the brand name Cumitin. Normally, it is used as an anticoagulant by the patients for the treatment of deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, atrial fibrillation, and in valvular heart disease, even in case of pregnant women. Warfarin is maximum effective during its critical time, that is between 6 to 9 weeks gestation. However, this pharmaceutical teratogen is able to cross the placental barrier. Thereby, it reaches the circulation of the embryo, where it results in malformed infants with low birth weight, microcephaly. Microcephaly is lowering the size of the head and thus the brain. As you see, this is the size of the normal head, whereas this is a child which is caused with microcephaly. Another abnormality is hypoplasia of the nasal bridge. There can be certain eye abnormalities. The child may suffer with seizures in its lifetime. Hypotonia, mental retardation is a common feature. Then is brachydactyly, malformed limbs, joints, and it also affects the extremities. As you see here, this diagram shows, this photograph shows a clubbed thumb, that is the size of the nail, and thus the tip of the finger is quite small. Though it does not affect the person much in any way, but this is a common feature that can be seen when the mother is exposed to warfarin, and thus this is the common feature in the child. Next pharmaceutical teratogen is mefloquine. Mefloquine is generally used as a potent, effective anti-malarial drug. That is, it is effective against Plasmodium falciparum. In early gestation, if exposure to mefloquine may induce minimal extension of the lateral brain ventricles and renal pelvis together, and there is some delayed ossification, that is bone formation in the fetus. However, it is considered safe during second and third trimester. The prenatal exposure in early pregnancy is considered neither lethal nor teratogenic to the embryo. Next category is that of endocrine disruptors. So, endocrine disruptors are the exogenous chemicals that disrupt the development of the embryo by interfering with the synthesis and normal functions of the hormones. That is, these affect the endocrine system of the growing embryo. They induce majorly physiological alterations in the embryo or fetus, leading to phenotypic alterations, in contrast to the anatomical features that were caused because of the pharmaceutical teratogens. So these physiological alterations that are caused in the embryo or fetus, they become apparent generally later in the adult life. They may or may not be visible in the child as soon as it is born. So later in adult life, these alterations, the physiological alterations, may become apparent, and thus they may persist for generations after exposure to the disruptor. Major endocrine disruptors include diethyl stilbestrol, that is DEAs, bisphenol A, that is BPA, certain phthalates, and trimethylactin. Now, these endocrine disruptors or the EDs are present in many pesticides and herbicides. The commonly used herbicide atrazine. They are the chemicals in the materials that line baby bottles and any of the brightly colored plastic containers that we see around us, in which we drink water or we take food. So the chemicals which are used in them, and also the chemicals which are used in cosmetics, in the sunblock creams, hair dyes, and also the chemicals that are used in preventing clothing from becoming highly inflammable. So all those kind of chemicals, if they affect a pregnant woman, then they affect the child's development in severe ways. So how do they affect the hormone function? They majorly act as agonists, that is, they bind to a hormone receptor with high affinity and thereby activate it. That is, they mimic the effect of a normal hormone. They prevent the natural hormone from binding to its receptor, and they themselves go and sit in the place of that hormone. Here the example is bisphenol A. So BPA and diethylstilbestrol DES, they bind to the estrogen receptor, and thus they mimic the hormone estrogen, which is required in the development of female reproductive tract. So from here you can make out that if there is exposure of BPA and DES to the pregnant woman, then the child will have a defective reproductive tract if the fetus is a female. Second mechanism by which endocrine disruptors may act is by acting as antagonists. That is, they inhibit the binding of a hormone to its receptor, or they may block the synthesis of a hormone altogether. For example, DDE, which is a metabolic byproduct of the insecticide DDT. You all must have heard this insecticide DDT, though it is banned in many parts of the world today. So this DDE, which is a metabolic product which is formed during the metabolism of DDT in the body, it can act as an anti-testosterone agent. It binds to the androgen receptor and it prevents the normal testosterone from functioning. That is, it affects the male reproductive system. The third mechanism by which these endocrine disruptors may bind is that they affect the synthesis, elimination, or transportation of a hormone in the body. For example, the herbicide atrazine, it elevates the synthesis of estrogen and can convert testes into ovaries in frogs. That is, it converts the sex of the frog embryo. Similarly, rats exposed to polychlorinated biphenyls, that is PCB pollutants, have low levels of thyroid hormones. The PCBs are able to compete for the binding sites of the thyroid hormone transport. So when unbound, the thyroid hormones are removed from the body. Another feature by which these endocrine disruptors act is that they make the organism more sensitive to hormones which will come up later in life. For example, if there is BPA exposure during fetal development, it will make the breast tissue more responsive to steroid hormones during puberty of the child that is born, that is around almost 13 to 14 years of its birth. The child may suffer from certain abnormalities in its breast tissue. The first and foremost example of endocrine disruptors is diethylstilbestrol, that is DES. DES is a synthetic estrogen which was earlier used to ease pregnancy and prevent miscarriages. It was very commonly used from 1940s to 1970. However, it was banned in 1971 when a specific type of vaginal cancer, that is adenocarcinoma, was discovered in some of the women who were exposed to DES when they were in the form of embryo, that is in utero, when they were exposed, that is their mothers were exposed, but these women got adenocarcinoma many years later. So we can say these were the DES daughters who were exposed. So this is the diagram of a normal female reproductive tract in which there is uterus, there is cervix, there is vagina. So here you see that the uterus is T-shaped when it is when this DES daughter has been exposed to DES during its in utero times. So the uterus is constricted, it is T-shaped, and there is adenosis of cervix and vagina seen. Cervical dysplasia, that is some kind of precancerous growth, has also been observed in the cervix region, and also the tissue hood of cervix as shown in the diagram. So all these are the complications of the cervix, the vagina, and of the uterus. So some cells are becoming cancerous. There can be ectopic pregnancies in case of these DES daughters when they will become pregnant. So there are quite high chances of ectopic pregnancy. So all these effects are of DES when it is exposed to the mothers, that the effects are caused in the daughters several years later. So there are also certain other complications like uterine fibroids, there can be endometriosis, there can be breast cancer, miscarriage, and ectopic pregnancies. Now the symptoms in human and mice include that DES interferes with the sexual and gonadal development by causing cell type changes in the female reproductive tract, which includes the derivatives of Blairian duct, which forms the upper portion of the vagina, cervix, uterus, and ovary ducts. That is, all the organs which are majorly included in the female reproductive tract, they are affected because of the exposure to DES. So there is a boundary between the oviduct and uterus, which is known as uterotubal junction. This uterotubal junction is lost, which results in infertility, and there is also a high risk for other reproductive health problems in the child that is born. DES actually functions by repressing the expression of HOX and WNT genes in the mammalian. And these HOX and WNT genes are generally involved in the specification and morphogenesis of the reproductive tissues. That is why the reproductive tissues are maximum affected by DES as a direct. Next endocrine disruptor is bisphenol A, that is BPA. BPA was first developed as a synthetic estrogen and was commonly used during 1930s. Today, BPA is used in the manufacturing of polymers, which includes the epoxy resins which lines the food and beverage cans, the polycarbonate plastic in baby bottles, the children's toys, and also the water bottles that we generally use. BPA is also used in dental sealant, and it may sound strange, but they are used in cash register receipts and there's flame retardant on the fabrics. So BPA has got an extensive usage in the materials around. However, BPA exposure during in utero conditions of the embryo is linked with its reproductive failure. It also causes polycystic ovarian syndrome in the female child that is born. It may lead to cancer, it shows some skeletal deformities and also behavioral abnormalities later in life. BPA is a teratogen which crosses the human placenta. It reaches the circulation of the fetus and causes abnormalities in fetal gonads, which includes abnormal meiotic chromosome behavior, certain aberrant follicle formation in the ovaries, and also altogether ovarian abnormalities. It may cause some prostate enlargement. It may cause low sperm counts and also leads to certain behavioral changes when these fetuses become adult. BPA also has the power to reverse the sex of a male frog, and it causes certain weight changes in the uterus of a young mouse. It can also cause certain chromosomal anomalies in the fetus. However, very high doses of BPA may lead to miscarriage also. So this may occur by prevention of the sex-specific maturation of ovulation-regulating parts, as demonstrated in the mouse brain during experiments. BPA is also linked to predisposition to cancer. That is, BPA appears to make breast tissue most sensitive to estrogens when there is in utero exposure to. So it predisposes women to breast cancer later in life. Next endocrine disruptor is atrazine, which is a herbicide. It acts through hormone synthesis. So atrazine induces enzyme aromatase synthesis first that induces female sex determination in many vertebrates, as has been seen in turtles, amphibians and crocodiles. The survival of these vertebrate species may be at risk from herbicides, because these herbicides promote estrogens at the expense of testosterone. Thereby, most of the males are converted into females. So this causes a depletion in the number, or even if the male is produced, then the male functionality or the male fertility is highly reduced. So it is a risk to the male population of the vertebrates. Next endocrine disruptor is the polychlorinated biphenyls, or the PCBs as they are generally called. PCBs are again synthetic chemicals which are used effectively in electrical equipments such as insulating fluids, heat exchangers, plasticizers, wood finishes, and also as chemical additives. From last 40 years, they have been known worldwide as pollutants. However, in utero exposure to the fetus causes the birth of infants, which at the time of birth show some parchment-like skin with desquamation and brown coloration. Thus, the baby is known as a polar baby. The baby also has dark-colored nails. It may show certain symptoms of conjunctivitis, low birth weight, exophthalmia, little teeth may be present, which otherwise are never seen in the normal babies when they are born. So birth weight may be quite low, or the head size can be small with hypotonicity and hyporeflexia, impaired cognitive functions. It may show certain altered sexual development, or its exposure may have certain deleterious effects on the gonads and the reproductive tract of the child. The next category is that of industrial teratogens, which includes heavy metals. The first heavy metal that we study under this category is lead. Lead is a cumulative poison generally found in natural environment. It mimics the role of calcium in the body. The critical period of exposure of lead is between 12 to 14 weeks of gestation in humans. Exposure of lead to the fetus through maternal ingestion of food and beverages which contain lead, or the lead which is stored in the mother's bone and released into her bloodstream. That is, even if during pregnancy the mother is not exposed, but before pregnancy the mother was exposed and lead was stored in her bones. So during pregnancy that lead came to be released into her bloodstream and crossed the placenta, and it may reach the growing embryo. Or even the lead exposure has been seen postpartum to the child from the breast milk that the mother feeds. So lead accumulates in the fetal brain, where it causes a number of neurological defects. Lead impairs the cell adhesion during development of nervous system, and thereby it alters the neuronal migration. Lead may lead to spontaneous abortion and stillbirth. Even low levels of lead exposure are associated with decreased intelligence, impaired neurobehavioral development, decreased stature and growth of the child. Apart from it, there can be impaired hearing acuity, there can be certain skin tags, there can be skin papillae or undescended testes, which causes male infertility in the child when it was exposed in utero to lead. So basically, the association is known as vectoral association. Vectoral, where V stands for vertebral, A for anal, C for cardiac, T for tracheoesophageal fistula, R for renal, and L for limb abnormalities. So vectoral association has been reported with prenatal exposure to high levels of lead. The next heavy metal is methyl mercury under industrial intelligence, which is extremely toxic to humans, and the fetus is even more sensitive to mercury than an adult. Methyl mercury accumulates in the fetal tissues, predominantly in the brain, after traversing through placenta. And congenital minamata disease, it is a name which is quite apparent if you search for this. This was the disease which happened in Japan in 1959. So this disease occurred in epidemic proportions on the Japanese island of Minamata after the maternal ingestion. It was seen in case of both humans and cats. So when the mothers ingested methyl mercury contaminated shellfish in this Minamata area of Japan, then there was an epidemic proportion of this congenital Minamata disease. That is, most of the children that were born in 1959 or even years after that in this island of Japan, they were showing certain teratogenic effects because of methyl mercury exposure to the mother during pregnancy. A similar exposure occurred in Iraq, where the ingestion of bread, which was prepared from wheat, which was treated with this teratogen methyl mercury, where it was thought that it is being used as a fungicide. So it also caused certain epidemic proportions of the disease among the children that were the congenital diseases in Iraq. So methyl mercury poisoning produces atrophy of the granular layer of the cerebellum and spongiose softening in the visual cortex and also other cortical areas of the brain. It also causes polyneuritis. The next category is that of cadmium. So cadmium is a heavy metal pollutant produced during the smelting of other metals. It has many industrial and domestic uses. It is commonly used in some paints, plastics, fertilizers, metal plating, rechargeable batteries, as well as it is found in cigarettes. Long-term exposure to cadmium during pregnancy leads to preterm childbirth. Cadmium-mediated teratogenicity may occur due to altering levels of retinoic acid by disrupting the expression of retinoic acid metabolizing genes or impaired endogenous nitrous oxide. It is also linked to increased oxidative stress and also activated apoptotic pathways in the child. The next heavy metal is lithium, which has been associated with possibly by affecting WNT beta catenin signaling. Effects that are categorized under this includes malformations of the central nervous system, of the ear, of the ureters, or there can be altered thyroid and fetal cardiac teratogenesis, which is known as Epstein anomaly and tricuspid atresia, which occurs in the and congenital goiter. Goiter, as you see, is the enlargement of the thyroid gland. Infants exposed in utero to lithium experience transient lethargy, hypotonia, cyanosis, poor feeding, poor respiratory efforts during the early neonatal. Arsenic is another heavy metal which causes malformation in the urinogenital system. It may cause skeletal abnormalities or micromania. The next category is that of microbial teratogens. The next category among the teratogens is microbial teratogens, which includes the infectious microorganisms, which is among the leading cause of neonatal morbidity and mortality despite the availability of a large number of vaccines and drugs. Teratogenic symptoms include micro-immature birth, growth retardation, neurological abnormalities, bone lesions, damage to eye, liver, heart, and ear. Major infectious microorganisms that are included in this category of microbial teratogens are rubella, or the German measles, cytomegalovirus, varicella zoster, Zika virus, toxoplasma, treponema, and parvovirus. The first is rubella, which is just the German measles. So rubella is a mild contagious viral infection. Critical period is during the first 5 weeks of pregnancy. Abnormalities include microcephaly, microphthalmia, cataract, glaucoma, cardiac anomalies, besides causing deafness or even mental retardation. It may lead to certain physical problems, possibly death in the child. So a fetus which is infected with rubella in the first trimester of gestation period shows high chances of being born with congenital rubella syndrome, CRS. Which includes heart malformation, eye cataracts. As you can see that this newly born child has this cataract in its eyes. There may be certain skin lesions. Intellectual disability is a common feature, growth retardation, and even deafness. Children are generally vaccinated against rubella with the MMR vaccine, which was introduced in 1969. Women who are not immune to rubella and are planning a pregnancy should again be vaccinated with the MMR vaccine at least 28 days before becoming pregnant, because the vaccine contains a live virus. Also, this is the reason that the pregnant woman should not be vaccinated. The second important microbial teratogen is the cytomegalovirus. CMV infection in the early gestation period is nearly always fatal. However, in the later periods, it leads to certain anomalies, which includes microcephaly, chorioretinitis, that is infection in the chorion and retina, then blindness, deafness, cerebral palsy, hemolytic anemia, mental retardation, or also enlarged spleen or enlarged liver. Varicella zoster virus, that again falls under the category of microbial teratogens, is a form of herpes virus. Infection with varicella zoster during the 6th to 20th week of gestation, which generally occurs by person-to-person transmission, that is by direct contact, or it may occur through air to the pregnant woman. So such a child when born can show symptoms of all these organs, which are collectively termed as congenital varicella syndrome, CVS, in the baby, which includes abnormalities of the nervous system, which includes the cortical atrophy, microcephaly, seizures may be seen in the child, or even mental retardation. Besides causing defects of muscle and bone, there can be malformed limbs or even paralyzed limbs. That is, limbs may not be functional at all, though they may be present, or they may be present in very small size. There can be lesions on the skin. There can be anomalies of the eye, such as microphthalmia, there can be cataract, there can be blindness, or there are also abnormalities in the gastrointestinal tract, the genitourinary tract, or even the cardiovascular system, besides causing a delay in the development of the baby. However, rarely such syndrome is seen in the baby if infection occurs post 20 week of gestation. That is, post 20 week of gestation, if the child is exposed to varicella zoster, it does not cause much anomalies in the child. Immediate treatment of the baby after birth, if there was an exposure to the mother during the gestation period, is that the baby is given an injection with of VZIG, that is varicella zoster immune globulin, that is antibodies, which can prevent, or they can severity can be lessened of the infection. Zika virus is the next teratogen. It is able to cross the placenta and comes into the fetal circulation, where the virus proliferates in the fetal brain tissues. Thus, it infects the progenitor neural cells. So, if the progenitor neural cells are affected, it leads to the growth failure and also the death of the neural cells. So, if the neural cells are undergone death or they die, it causes fear, central nervous system defects. The central nervous system defected in the fetus of infected mother shows symptoms like microcephaly, ventriculomegaly, cerebral calcifications, the corpus callosum may be absent, or the cerebellum may be atrophied, or even the brain stem may not be properly developed. Infection with Toxoplasma gondii, which is a protozoan parasite and is spread by cat feces, which is its definitive host, can also cause certain teratogenic effects in the baby. Toxoplasma gondii infection in the mother can cross the placenta. So these microbes may lead to spontaneous abortion of the child. They may cause some premature deliveries, or even the neurological problems like mental retardation, blindness, and cerebral palsy, besides causing low birth weight, hepatitis, lymphadenopathy, and anemia in the child. In early pregnancy, however, the placenta is an effective barrier to the parasite. So that means that Toxoplasma gondii infection in the early pregnancy will not affect the child much. However, the risk of transmission increases with increasing gestational age. However, the severity of fetal disease decreases with increasing gestational age. Treponema pallidum is the next microbial teratogen. It causes syphilis, which is a sexually transmitted disease. Early infection to pregnant females most often results in spontaneous abortion. However, children which are born with this infection are anemic and they suffer from a condition which is known as congenital syphilis, that is syphilis which is right from the time of birth. And such children suffer from seizures, spleen and liver malformations besides showing some skin lesions. A nasal discharge is quite common besides having some joint pain. Infection during late pregnancy results in other anomalies such as deafness, certain cardiovascular defects, certain dental defects, or even abnormalities of the bone. Parvovirus. Human parvovirus B19 is able to cross the placenta and thereby results in fetal infection. So even if the mother is not showing any symptoms of this parvovirus infection, the child may be infected and severely affected. That is because human parvovirus B19 has shown certain affinity for the erythropoietic tissues of the fetus. Thereby, it causes fetal anemia, leading to cardiac failure. Infection with parvovirus leads to spontaneous abortion if it infects the fetus or the embryo in the first trimester of gestation. Hydrops fetalis if it is affecting in the second trimester, and at term, is it full term of pregnancy, it may lead to stillbirth. It leads to generalized myocarditis, myositis of skeletal muscles, and certain abnormalities of the eyes in the child. The next category of teratogens are the recreational teratogens. So these recreational teratogens are the ones which are just taken as recreation. They are not a part of any drug or any course that is given to the pregnant mothers otherwise. So these can be easily avoided. Recreational teratogens are associated with reduced fetal and postnatal growth, and they also show infant mortality. Major recreational teratogens are the alcohol, tobacco, cocaine, marijuana, lysergic acid, diethylamide, or the LSD, as it is commonly called. The first is the alcohol. In terms of the frequency of its effects and its cost to society, the most devastating teratogen is undoubtedly alcohol. Alcohol means the ethanol. The alcohol is easily able to cross the placental barriers and it enters the fetal circulatory system, where it blocks several critical functions in the brain, and it also leads to facial impairment in the child. Fetus suffers from hypoxia and malnutrition, because the placental blood flow is considerably reduced. It also causes vascular constriction. In 1968, Lemoyne and colleagues noticed a syndrome of birth defects in the children which were born to alcoholic mothers. Even a single episode of consuming the equivalent of two alcoholic drinks during pregnancy may lead to loss of fetal brain cells. So even before the mother knows that she is pregnant, the effects of alcohol can severely damage the fetus. The symptoms in babies born to mothers exposed to alcohol includes a number of abnormalities which are collectively referred to as fetal alcohol syndrome or FAS. The facial features of FAS include small head circumference, the small eye opening as you see, a small midface, thin upper lip. There can be skin folds at the corners of the eye. The nasal bridge may be quite low in height, short nose, and also indistinct philtrum, that is the groove between nose and upper. So these are all the facial features, that is a part of the abnormalities that can be caused during fetal alcohol. The brain of children which are born to alcoholic mothers may be dramatically smaller than normal and often shows poor development. The results of deficiencies of neuronal and glial migration with low IQ, a mean of which is seen generally 68. Apart from it, there are certain behavioral abnormalities also. Recent techniques that could identify neural tracts in the brain have found certain abnormalities that correlate with altered mental processing speed and also executive functioning. Executive functioning means planning, memorizing, and retaining information. There is another term that is fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, FASD, which has been coined to encompass all the alcohol-induced malformations and functional defects that occur, including the FAS. Now, how does alcohol shows its effects? So the mechanism of action of alcohol is by interference with the neural crest migration, that is, it interferes with cell migration, with cell proliferation, cell-to-cell adhesion, and even the cellular survival. So instead of normal migration and division, the ethanol-treated neural crest cells prematurely initiate their differentiation into facial cartilage. So this premature differentiation causes some deformities in the facial cartilage. Thereby, the nose and upper lip of the ethanol-exposed pups of mice, as shown experimentally, are poorly developed. The nervous system problems involve failure to close the neural tube and also incomplete development of the forebrain. There is also generation of superoxide radicals when there is exposure of the fetus to alcohol. And these superoxide radicals are able to damage cell membranes and also lead to apoptosis of neurons. There is also seen certain downregulation of the expression of sonic hedgehog genes. And as you know, sonic hedgehog genes are important in establishing the facial midline structure. There is also seen certain interference with the ability of the cell adhesion molecule L1 to hold the cells together. That is, the cell adhesion is lost. The next recreational teratogen is tobacco. Tobacco causes risk of premature delivery, spontaneous abortion, or even fetal death. Maternal nicotine consumption, nicotine which is predominantly present in tobacco, is highly teratogenic. The teratogenic effects includes predominantly the impairment of the placental blood flow to the, which causes chronic hypoxia in the fetus and also malnutrition. And this hypoxia and malnutrition lead to a number of embryonic defects, which includes reduction in fetal weight because the fetus is not able to grow properly. It does not get proper oxygen and nutrition because the placental flow is blocked by nicotine. And there is reduction in length, there is reduction in size of head, there is abnormal development of certain facial anomalies, for example, cleft lip, cleft palate. It leads to increased incidence of attention hyperactivity disorder, that is, the child is not able to attentively focus on the things and also shows certain hyperactive disorders. And it leads to major depressive disorder and substance abuse, which is commonly seen in children which are born to exposed. Whether these symptoms are caused by nicotine, that is the smoke exposure itself, or by genetic or psychosocial mechanisms, that is the mother is taking, so the child starts to take the substances when in later in life, that thing is still not completely elucidated. The next recreational teratogen is cocaine. Cocaine is an active component, the active component of cocaine is benzoyl methyl guaine, which is an alkaloid that occurs in the plant Erythroxylum coca. Cocaine blocks the presynaptic reuptake of neurotransmitters at the nerve terminals. Vascular disruption of placenta is a common feature which reduces blood flow from uterus to the placenta. And this vascular disruption of placenta induces fetal hypoxia, that is reduction in the oxygen and also reduction in the nutrition, which leads to malnutrition. This significantly reduces fetal weight because the fetus does not get enough oxygen and nutrition, and also increases the rate of malformations or the deformity. The structural defects include retarded growth, microcephaly, urinogenital anomalies, and also anomalies in the neuronal system and anomalies in the behavior of the child. Cocaine exposure has also been linked with premature delivery, spontaneous abortion, and fetal death. Marijuana and LSD, which are again the recreational teratogens. Marijuana's active ingredient is 8,9-tetrahydrocannabinol. And marijuana exposure is linked to growth retardation and malformations, especially if the exposure is there in the first trimester. Increased risk of non-lymphoblastic leukemia is also. Lysergic acid diethylamide or the LSD causes defects in the limbs, eyes, central nervous system, and it also is linked with arthrogyrosis in the children which are born to mothers who used LSD before or during pregnancy. So these things, even if not taken during pregnancy, so even before pregnancy, if they are taken, they may keep on lingering in the circulation of the mother, and thus they affect the child which is born to the mother who was taking these recreational teratogens, whether it is alcohol, whether it is marijuana, LSD, cocaine, tobacco. Now, apart from these, there are certain metabolic conditions also in the mother which can act as teratogens. Number one is the insulin-dependent diabetes. So, if the mother has diabetic condition, it causes malformations which includes multiple organ systems of the fetus. The fetus shows increased incidence of congenital cardiac, skeletal, renal, gastrointestinal, and central nervous system malformations, prominently the neural tube defects. There is also seen caudal dysplasia, risk of stillbirth, and also neonatal death. The risk of such defects is almost 3 to 4 times higher with the diabetes mothers. And these defects can be controlled if the mother is given insulin therapy. The second metabolic condition of mother is phenylketonuria, in which the offsprings of mothers were suffering from phenylketonuria, which is the high levels of phenylalanine in the blood or urine. They have a significant risk of mental retardation, microcephaly, intrauterine growth retardation, low birth defect, and congenital heart disease in the child that is born to such. The next metabolic condition is nutritional stress or malnutrition of the mother. Now, if the mother is malnourished or has some kind of stress with respect to its nutrition, so the developing fetus is not able to fulfill its requirements from the mother through placenta. So the nutritional stress to pregnant mother directly affects the growth of the fetus and makes the fetus more prone to infections and diseases even after it is born. The abnormal development without mutation may occur with the age of the mother. As the age of the mother between 20 to 35 years is considered optimum for childbearing. If the mother's age is less than 20 or higher than 35, then infant mortality is shown to be little increased. Mothers which are approaching the menopause may have certain endocrine disorders which may slow down the development of the embryo or the fetus, and it is also linked with certain developmental irregularities in the child like cretinism, mongolism and heart malformation, and may also involve certain physical and mental defects. Hyperthermia, that is the high body temperatures of the mother which stay higher than 38.9 degrees Celsius, which may be a fever or which may be sauna, the exposure of mother to sauna bath. So such high body temperatures cause severe mental deficiency. Seizures in infancy, microphthalmia, mid-phase hypoplasia, and also mild distal limb abnormalities in infants. Another condition is stress. The emotional state of the mother, that is stress, can affect the unborn baby. Then certain mechanical factors, for example, the amniotic bands, which are the fibrous rings, which cause intrauterine amputations or malformations of the limbs. They may cause malformations of the limbs. The malformations of the uterus may restrict fetal movements, since the fetus begins to move inside the uterus during the late gestation period. So malformations of the uterus restrict those movements of the fetus, and thus they may be associated with congenital dislocation of the hip and causes club foot in the fetus. Oligohydramnios is another condition which can have similar results, and mechanically it may induce abnormalities of the fetal limbs. In this case, the abnormalities are classified as deformations or abnormal forms, shapes or positions of the body parts which are caused because of physical constraints. So this is all about the topic teratogenesis. Let us summarize the topic in a snapshot. We studied that exogenous agents which cause birth defects or congenital anomalies in the form of a permanent abnormality in structure or function or restriction of growth or even cause death of the embryo or fetus is termed as a teratogen. Process of which leads to the formation of a congenital anomaly is called teratogen. What are teratogens? They induce deviations from normal embryonic development, which may include death, malformation, growth retardation, or a functional defect in the offspring. The effect of teratogen on the embryo depends on timing and dose or intensity of the exposure, as we saw in the diagram of the complete gestation period that in the beginning of the lecture. Or the critical sensitive period of embryonic development. The critical sensitive period is the period of organogenesis and differentiation when the embryo is most vulnerable to the effects of the teratogens if they are exposed to it, and also the genetic constitution of the developing embryo, in which we studied the examples of few alleles which make or predispose the child or the embryo to the effects of teratogens or may prevent the effect of teratogens in the embryo. The first category of teratogens, that is the natural teratogens, include phytochemicals and ionizing radiations, predominantly the gamma radiations, which cause chromosomal breakage and alter the DNA structure. The second category, that is the pharmaceutical teratogens, include thalidomide, retinoic acid, valproic acid, mefloquine. Endocrine disruptors, which disrupt the development by interfering with the synthesis and normal functions of the hormones, that is the endocrine system, and thereby inducing major physiological alterations in the embryo or fetus, leading to phenotypic alterations. Major endocrine disruptors include diethylstilbestrol, that is DES, bisphenol A, that is BPA, herbicide atrazine, and polychlorinated biphenyls, that is PCA. Industrial teratogen category includes heavy metals which are released as environmental exposures. Majorly, the lead, methyl mercury, cadmium, lithium are included under teratogenic category. The category of microbial teratogens include Coxsackie virus, herpes simplex virus, rubella, or the German measles, साइटोमेगेलो वायरस, वेरिसेला जोस्टर, जीका वायरस, टॉक्सोप्लाज्मा, ट्रेपोनिमा, पार्वो वायरस। रिक्रिएशनल टेराटोजेंस इंक्लूडेड कोहल, कोकेन, लिसर्जिक एसिड, डाइथाइलामीन, दैट इज एलएसडी, मैरिजुआना एंड टबेको। मेटाबॉलिक कंडीशंस इन द मदर, फॉर एग्जांपल इंसुलिन डिपेंडेंट डायबिटीज और सर्टेन डायटरी डेफिशिएंसीज, मैल न्यूट्रिशन और फिनाइल पिटूनरिया मे आल्सो अफेक्ट द ग्रोथ ऑफ द फीटस। हाउएवर एज ऑफ द मदर, स्ट्रेस ड्यूरिंग प्रेगनेंसी, हाइपरथर्मिया एंड सर्टेन मैकेनिकल फैक्टर्स मे आल्सो कॉज सम डिफेक्ट्स इन द फीटल ग्रोथ। दीज आर सम ऑफ द रेफरेंसेस दैट हैव बीन कंसल्टेड फॉर प्रिपरेशन ऑफ कंटेंट ऑफ दिस लेक्चर। Hope you had a good time listening to me. Thank you. Happy learning.